It's time for the Retirement Inside Out podcast, taking you on a deep dive into the demands of today's retirement industry. Your host is the Director of Marketing for Financial Independence Group, which has been a leader in the financial services space for more than 40 years. Here's Tom Lamondola.
Welcome to Retirement Inside Out, a deep dive into the demands of today's retirement industry. I'm your host and Director of Marketing here at Financial Independence Group, Tom Lamondola. And today, I have the pleasure to be joined by White Glove Senior Vice President, Brad Swineheart. Brad, what's up, man?
Hey, buddy. Thanks for having me on. Excited.
Yeah, absolutely. Appreciate you joining here. And I know that for the folks listening, they're going to have certainly the advisors who either have worked with you all in the past or have considered working with you or just need help with marketing. I know we're going to have a great show for them and definitely a lot of stuff to share, especially with all the learnings that I would say that I've at least talked with you about since we formed a relationship over two years ago. So on our side, mine and yours specifically, obviously FIG and All Points Media has been working with White Glove since your inception, but you and I got to know each other about 2 years ago. So anyway, I thought it'd be a good place maybe to start, and just for those, if they were living under a rock and didn't try to figure out how to do marketing in 2020 and into 2021, they didn't know who White Glove was, maybe we could start there a little bit, just tell the audience who you guys are and how you help advisors, please.
Yes, so, you know, 2015, early 2016, White Glove kind of came onto the scene. We were founded by financial advisors who for 30 years did seminars to build their practice, a very successful practice. And quite frankly, they hated it because there's a lot of work. There's a lot of financial risk involved. You know, they're dropping mailers and they put the wrong address on there, or it's Detroit, right? So a snowstorm happens in July and nobody shows up, or the library shuts down or something crazy. But there was so much financial risk, and there's just so much minutia when it comes to event planning and marketing and all of that. So they kind of looked around the industry to say, hey, who could we partner with? Couldn't find somebody that did everything that they wanted off their plates. And that's really the light bulb moment where White Glove came around, where we want to just focus on helping advisors get in front of new prospects, do what they do best, and we handle absolutely everything else. So we came onto the scene with a very simple business model where we're going to do all the work, we're going to do all the marketing, we're going to pay for everything up front. And the advisor is totally protected. They only pay after the event on actual attendance. And we thought we were so good at it, we'd guarantee a client. And really, that was it. That little sales pitch and that business model led us up to the beginning of 2020, where we were doing close to 800 in-person events all across the US and Canada every single month. You know, March, we were very much in the same boat as financial advisors in the industry. So instead of doing 800 in-person seminars, we did zero. Yeah. And we were pretty uniquely positioned in the industry where we're used to doing all of the work. We have a great marketing algorithm and base that can attract the right consumers and get them to take action. And we immediately transitioned over to offering webinars. We now offer webinars, social media management, podcasting, as well as direct one-on-one introductions for advisors. And all with that same mentality in place of advisors should spend their time working with prospects and talking to clients, and anything else they do is taking away from their business.
Yeah, I've been in a relationship when they're just first starting to launch Social Connect and some of the other digital engagement and digital marketing tactics that were out there that others that might have been in your same competitive sleeve inside the industry hadn't quite grasped yet. Because what I like to say is, all of the financial services world that were doing seminars didn't need to change, you know. So we've all been pitching kind of that digital is coming, digital is here, but everything was successful. And so folks were like, well, I don't really need to change. But like I said, White Glove was already ahead of the curve a little bit in trying to create and devise programs and strategies that advisors and agents could bolt onto, along with, you know, the workshop type of stuff, which I thought was pretty cool as well too.
And we actually did webinars long before the pandemic. That was something that we had tried, we tested, we'd run a bunch of, you know, ads, and we set those things up. But the advisor willingness to do them and then the consumer demand was just a totally different atmosphere. And one thing that we found, you know, going into March and April of 2020 is that almost then more than ever before in industry, consumers needed more financial information. They needed to understand what the heck was going on. You know, not only did you have the pandemic, but you had the stock market doing all sorts of crazy things, you know, rolling into this year with all the new potential tax changes and everything that's going on and how that affects your retirement. Now more than ever, you know, advisors need to be educating their communities, and they just have to find a way to do that and now a new hybrid environment.
Yeah. Yeah. That, you know, that's a great point that I think, well, I know that we haven't talked about enough on this podcast is the current retail client's thirst for knowledge that probably was, or and how they want to be served that type of knowledge. Because before, to your point, they didn't need to, everybody was kind of comfortable, especially after the 2008-2009 crisis. We had a good run there of what, 11, 12 years almost totally, that was, people were just good. You know, the market was good. The baby boomers hadn't quite started to reach the pinnacle of retirement yet. They probably wanted to work a little bit longer because everything was great. But then, yeah, now all of a sudden, information becomes so much more important and then widely accessible. And if you're not one of those individuals delivering that information in some type of medium, you're going to get beat. You know, there is somebody out there that's going to do it, especially some of the younger up and coming advisors that are out there that get it and understand that networking today is having a very strong digital network, along with still going to your Rotary clubs and your local communities and things like that. But you still need to, I mean, now you're more than ever, you got to have that digital network for sure.
Well, information is just free, right? We all carry around every bit of information we'd ever need right in our pocket. And so does all your top clients, and so does all your top prospects. And, you know, we're at a time now where you have to be willing to meet people where they want to digest that information. Some people want to read it off Facebook. Some people want to read it off a professional website. Some people want to do LinkedIn. Some people want to go to a lunch and learn. Some people want to go to a library. And you're going to have your ideal prospect or even your existing ideal client want to be served information in one of those channels. And if you're not willing to meet them there, then it's not like they're just going to give up and say, oh, I guess I don't need that information. They're just going to get it from somebody else.
Yeah, especially because we're talking about their money. You know,
you're right.
Try to buy a brand new pair of sneakers, we could lose interest real quickly in sneaker company A versus sneaker company B. But when we're talking about the pennies that I have in my savings account these days with three kids, but now it's all of a sudden different. You know, I'm going to pay a lot more attention. If you're not giving me that information that helps me turn those pennies into dimes and so on, then I'm just going to stop. You're right. I'm going to go find somebody else because there are people out there serving that information to my handheld or my streaming TV or, you know, whatever it might be these days.
Oh, and all sorts of information is being pushed at them from all sorts of resources, right? And, you know, some of that's credible, some of it's not, but it definitely is spurring thoughts inside of your prospects and your clients' brains right now of, ooh, maybe I need to know more about that. Who should I reach out to? And they're either going to reach out to you if you're available, convenient. You know, they see you on Facebook, or they see you, you know, hosting a webinar, or you're back to doing the in-person stuff. You know, they'll either go to what's convenient, or they'll just Google it themselves and find somebody else that might be running one of those types of events in your area.
Yeah. I know you study up on all things marketing and make sure that you're as well-versed and educated as you possibly can, so that you are dealing with the clients that you talk with on a regular basis, whether it's an individual producer or bigger groups like the Carson group there that we were talking about before the show started here. So, and we do marketing plans inside of FIG and our All Points Media team, but I guess just top of mind, what are some of the things when somebody says to you, hey, Brad, you know, I'm just struggling now in this new world of information, of free information. What are some of the top marketing tactics or strategies I really should be imploring into my business?
Yeah, and one thing that, you know, it really depends on what their focus is. If you're looking to fill that funnel, which I think is very important, you know, information is free. Education takes someone that has a likable personality. So one thing that we specialize in is making introductions. And that could be, you know, 2 years ago, that was through a seminar. Now it could be through seminars, which in-person seminars are 100% coming back. I mean, we're seeing areas open up that attendance is great, that both at restaurants and also, you know, educational venues, because restaurants is actually kind of unique for us because we typically didn't do that in the past. We offered it, but we really didn't do it very often. But now we're hearing on the consumer front that, hey, we know restaurants are clean. They have clear policies. You know, I'm comfortable going there, whereas I haven't been in a library in a year and a half. I don't know how often they clean a library, right? But an advisor, you know, being able to produce that not just that information, but to digest it down into something that's important to that consumer so they can understand it. that's really where you have to be in front of somebody. You have to be able to talk to them. And that doesn't mean standing in front of them in a physical audience or even in your office anymore. That can be virtual. It can be through a webinar. It can be through Zoom meetings. We found that could be amazingly efficient. You know, I think going into 2021 to see real success, you have to remember the things that really worked in 2019. And we got a lot of advisors that are very eager to get back to that. But you can't miss out on the efficiencies that we found in 2020. You know, the industry rang a very loud bell that said, you can learn all this stuff from home. You can get this education through your, while you're still sitting in your pajamas, right? And that's never going to go away. You're still going to have ideal prospects that want to learn that way. And they're more comfortable that way because there's a level of comfort that comes from not sitting directly in front of somebody.
Yeah, absolutely. And we're working a ton with folks on exactly what you just said. In fact, we had a conversation inside of our marketing team last week that was all about don't regress to the mean. You know, and because we're starting to get feedback from some of our top clients, they're saying, I know I was doing that webinar program, or I know I was doing that digital engagement program, but live events are coming back on board. So I'm really kind of scrapping all of that. And I'm going to just go back to my mailers and my live seminars because that's what worked. And the feedback we're saying is that's great. We're happy they're coming back. You know, we're huge believers in those live events. But to your point, I love what you said there about the efficiencies that we learned. Don't forget about the efficiencies there that we were able to show you on driving down some of those costs to acquire leads or cost per appointments or whatever the metrics are that are important. You and I would probably argue all of them are important, but we know that the advisors we work with don't necessarily track all of them. And that's really, I think, what probably is going to, if you're a marketer in today's world for financial professionals, is that's going to be the biggest hill to climb, I think, for us throughout the rest of this year and into 2022, is making sure that our clients don't regress to the mean of just going back to what you did before. Because you're now only doing one marketing funnel of the multiple that have been available to you. In some cases, you may have gotten really good at.
Yeah, and it's, I always tell advisors too, and it's, I'm happy if they track anything. So, you know, argue this or that, what they track, as long as they're starting to track is great. You know, and we've had advisors that just say, hey, webinars don't work. I don't want to do that. And I say, look, you know, seminars didn't work the first time you tried it either. So let's be real here. The first time you did a seminar, you probably didn't knock it out of the park. And I do believe that, you know, that we are going to see the pendulum swing back the other way, where, you know, we've been so virtual for so long that yes, in-person stuff's going to just see a huge surge, both from advisors and from consumers, that hey, let's just get out of the house, right? Let's just go do something. And we're going to ride that wave, obviously, and support. And we already have probably more events booked out for the end of the year than we have in a very long time. I mean, this month has been crazy with advisors planning ahead for when they get back from summer. But I see that pendulum kind of swinging back down to find somewhere, you know, neutral in the middle there, where in-person stuff's absolutely going to be a great way to get back at it. But there's webinars are still going to have, virtual options are still going to have a place in marketing going forward, because you can't pull that efficiency away from, you know, the consumers. If they can log on for 45 minutes and learn that and then go back to, you know, hanging out with the grandkids, that's what they're going to want to do. You know, that they don't always need to hop in a car. Yes, I think immediately in the fall, everyone's going to say, please just get me out of the house. I want to go do something, right? But you have to adapt to it. And advisors are known for, ooh, let's try this, and then not pay any attention to the results and go try this and then go try this and go try this. But ultimately you have to come back at it like you guys do there. And what we do at White Glove is really create a plan of how many households do you need to see? What does that conversion rate look like? And where's your highest conversion? Can you get, you know, can you pick up one client from a webinar, but two from an in-person? Well, then it's, the answer isn't, oh, switch all over to in-person. The answer is do them both, right? But move your webinars to different areas that you're comfortable getting clients from virtually. And now your inventory or your backyard is expanded. You know, what we always ran into with advisors causing their own problems is market saturation, where, you know, for every one high net worth client in Scottsdale, there's four advisors, right? And they're all dropping mailers just left and right, trying to trying to get in front of those people. And now with virtual, well, why don't you do one in Minneapolis instead? You know, why don't you do one in Southern California? Why don't you do a webinar over in, you know, the East Coast and Tom's backyard over there? And those things are available for advisors and allows them to see the growth that they want to. But back to your point, they have to track it. And if you're getting a positive ROI, then you do this and that, not this or that.
Yeah, really, truly, you truly compartmentalize that I of the ROI, which is the investment. You know, don't forget to reinvest and don't necessarily put it in your pocket, at least not all of it. You know, there's a portion of that that needs to be recommitted back in and reinvested back into the marketing if you want to grow. I mean, I guess you could argue to say if you want to maintain as well, too. Well, you brought up something that I wanted to ask you about as well is the virtual aspect now and the expanding of the geographies and expanding of the backyard, like you said. Are you getting those types of, I'm sure you're consulting like that, but are you also getting now inbound questions about that? Like, hey, Brad, should I start to expand now? I'm kind of beat down the Scottsdale area, but I would love to go 100 miles east because my wife's family or my husband's family is from over there. So I can either do it virtually or if need be, if I get enough clients, I'll drop in another office down there. Where are you starting to see some of those requests come in?
Oh, absolutely. We used to be consulting on it ahead of, you know, months and months ago when people were very like, well, I'm not sure if virtual is going to work. I'm not sure if I can convert. But so many advisors now are embracing it saying, hey, you know what? If you guys can pick me up clients, doesn't matter where they're at. You know, I'll close them virtually. If they're big enough, I'll fly out there. You know, there's no need for a strict brick and mortar. I can market 10 miles from my office and that's it. You know, that need is almost completely gone. And some of the advisors that we work with are always looking for more, 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 right? They know that here's all my fixed costs. The only variable cost I have is marketing. And that's the only one that will lead to real success and bring in, you know, that you're still going to pay rent. You're still going to pay your employees. You're still going to pay the water bill, right? Those are all fixed costs, but your marketing is the only variable there. And the more you put into that, as long as you're getting a positive ROI, then that's what you need to track. And that's your one expense that you should just be, if you're looking to grow, really dialed into and paying attention to what you have going on there.
Yeah. Do you all make recommendations as far as percentage of marketing budget or anything like that when you're talking with advisors starting to build out their marketing plan? Like, hey, let me help set you up at least what we say. We say, hey, you know, really, if you want to really grow to a pretty serious rate, and that's a pretty serious rate being definitely above 10 and probably more like 20 to 30% year over year, you should be willing to invest about 15 to 20% of your annual net new revenue, basically. So we're talking AUM clients, obviously, as that grows. That's why we wouldn't say over the total AUM revenue, but just of your net new revenue on that specific year or the year prior, that's what we consult on. And then when they tell us that, that's how, to your point, we start to build out that marketing plan and say, okay, well, now that you're willing to commit that 20%, this actual equals X in hard dollars, and we're gonna start to build out all of your activities there. You know, you're gonna do one white glove workshop for once, you know, once a month for 12 months, and you're gonna do this digital type of thing. So do you all do something like that or have a recommendation for folks?
Yeah, so, and we work with advisors that are, you know, strict insurance annuity guys all the way up to the registered reps that are focused on solely AUM, right? And it really depends on what their practice and what they're looking to do. You know, if you're making 1% year over year, then your ROI is going to be spread out a heck of a lot longer than the guy selling annuities that's getting an upfront commission. So we'll kind of look at that and then really kind of dive into their existing book too, as far as what do you have in your prospect pipeline now? Where are your best clients coming from? And then we can make a recommendation based on our services. So you have your seminars, webinars, direct one-on-one referrals that we offer, and that's all filling the pipeline, right? That's all, do you need more people? Is that your where you're really gonna make your money? Or you go over to the Social Connect side, which it's nurturing. It's a full year long of, okay, you did a webinar 6 months ago. This person isn't ready yet, but they're gonna be ready in 2 months. How do you stay in front of them in all of those ways that we just talked about, right? Websites, social media, email. Then you look at that nurturing platform and say, hey, do you have enough of an established prospecting book where this makes sense? Or even your client base, does this make sense? And you work off it that way. And then, you know, you get those guys that are just absolutely locked and loaded. They get their marketing budgets on plan, but they're looking for that extra credibility piece. They're looking for a nicer way to make referrals. Then we come over and we say, well, what about podcasting? That might be a great fit. Because as you know, running a podcast, how warm is that you know, introduction to say, ooh, you should listen to Tom's podcast. I would say that all day to somebody, especially now that I'm on it, right? But but that's such an easy, but that's such an easy conversation compared to, oh, you know, Tom does marketing, you should talk to him. No, but hey, listen to this podcast. So really what we do is we'll look at their goals and their budget, and then really kind of try to place the buckets where they need it. Do you need nurturing? Do you need lead generation? You know, and really stress the fact that you really need all of it. You shouldn't be doing seminars if you don't have a robust follow-up sequence. You shouldn't be doing webinars if you're not comfortable closing meetings via Zoom, right? And those are things that we'll help with and that we'll add on through some of our other services that we offer. But really, you got to kind of look at that whole package. And White Glove ultimately wants to be, and we have services available to go right from, you know, finding a prospect to referring client. And we can handle everything in between there, where all the advisor has to do is talk. And that's our goal. That's going to be something that we really push for, you know, going into the end of this year and beginning of next year. We got a lot of really cool new services coming out. But ultimately, that's where you're going to look at your budget when you're working with an advisor based on your business. Where do you need the most help? And, oh, do you want us just to do everything for you? Then this is what that product breakdown looks like.
Yeah, that fits in so well with what we do. Even more so as we go forward into 2022, we'll start our annual planning process with our clients in the August timeframe of every year, really. But this year specifically, this statement, I guess, is going to culminate a lot of what you and I have been talking about. But this year, we're going to really start to hone in on, hey, you can either brand or rebrand, so or enhance your brand or rebrand. You can drive prospects, or you can engage with your communities and with your audiences. And to your point, you need to be doing all three of those, but we will lose your attention if we try to do all three at once.
Right.
So, you know, we are going to take a look and we're going to analyze and we're going to prioritize with you, Mr. and Mrs. Client. And if you tell us, hey, you know what, I'm really good, but let's keep using the podcast example. I feel like I really need to build up my referral base and really build up my trust with some outbound easy marketing. Well, then podcast is it. You know, you already got a well-established brand in your community, but, you know, we want to expand maybe to other geographies or whatever it is. So we'll focus and get that individual invested and spun up onto a podcast, because it does take a lot. You know, you got to film a bunch of shows ahead of time, depending, I guess, on how many you want to put out there. And then bring it all the way through the cycle as well, too. So we're really going to start to do exactly what you said. So I'm happy to hear that you guys were locked up. Not that I didn't think we were, typically marketers are, but it's happy to hear that, because we can match up your programs. We can all be talking the same language to the advisor just in general, so they're hearing the same thing. You know, I think that's so important for us all who are in marketing for the financial services space, is to have that consistent message. And we certainly can zig when the others are zagging, so long as it makes sense and everybody else, you know, can see that as well too. But man, when we were talking about four or five different things or different ways to do things, I think that's when really our joint clients get lost, and that's what they truly look at. Marketing as an expense rather than an investment, because they only see the dollars going out the door.
Yeah. And it's tough. I mean, I really feel for both you guys, you know, at Financial Independence Group and the advisors you work with, because the industry is full of shiny objects, and it's, you're trying to pair all these things together, try to build a system yourself where, ooh, I like this brand and I like this service and I like this thing. And let's try to mesh all those things together and then pay attention to the ROI of all of them and see what happens. And, oh, you know, who's doing my email sequences? Who's doing my LinkedIn? Who's generating me leads or referrals? And try to put all those things together where no one really makes it easy. You know, there are all these different tools to put in your toolbox, where White Glove has always been that, well, we don't want to give you a tool. Like, that's just not our thing. We want to do it for you. And this year, you know, this last 18 months really has shown us more than anything else that there's a lot out there that we do very well, and that hiring and bringing in a lot of new resources just in the last 18 months for us has been just a total game changer of the things that we're going to be able to offer advisors as a total solution, as opposed to a piece of this very large puzzle that they're trying to put together and decide what works. Because I think that's one of the most frustrating things for anybody, you know, in marketing, sales, anything like that, is, you know, you have all these pieces and trying to figure out which ones you need to optimize in order to get better. And without seeing all that data all together and looking at the same thing, you know, does does this company consider a lead the same as this company considers a lead as compared to, you know, it's just like us, right? We charge based on an attended household, and we constantly get compared to, you know, the amount of mailers that get dropped or the amount of registrations that someone takes for an event. And they're all three of those things are totally different. And, you know, just doing the math on that is tough enough as it is for my salespeople. I can't even imagine an advisor getting sold from three different angles, you know, what they should focus on. So we really want to just be that, look, let's just take it from prospect to referring client. Let's do that for you. And let's make you look as best as possible. So all you can do is talk to clients, stand in front of people, be the expert that you are, right? Be likable, be trustworthy, be really good at your job, and then market the heck out of yourself. That's the rules for success there.
Yeah. Well, and to your point, then you all can help with that tracking of the data. You know, when it is too compartmentalized and maybe you or we or whomever their marketing company or their marketing partner is, I don't want to say in charge of all marketing, because I think that's a little bit aggressive, but at least have a hand in it and can help guide it. We can help show them, hey, this is a signal that this specific area of your marketing, maybe it's your LinkedIn engagement, is way, way down. What's going on? You know, let's really start to look at that and figure out, is it because we're sending the wrong information? Is the population not engaged anymore? You know, what is, have things changed? And then we need to look internally and say, okay, what's our content strategy, obviously? But that is an important piece that can help us frame up some of the marketing that we do for folks, specifically on the data side. You mentioned, and you guys are always working on new things to that point to really take the lift off of the advisor from a marketing and staying ahead of the curve and ahead of the industry. And I don't know if there's anything you can kind of just give us some of the sneak tip projects that you're working on, but you alluded to, you have some things in the hopper, and if it's not specific programs, what can you share that might be coming on deck or that you see coming to the industry at large?
Well, you know, one of the things that is really interesting being a part of White Glove in the last probably 18 to 24 months is we've engaged with a family of companies, private equity that owns Quicken, Rocket Mortgage. They're very big on the tech and financial space here in Detroit. And we've been kind of indoctrinated into this family of companies and getting to see behind the scenes of all these other highly successful financial related companies, what they're doing, what they have access to do. There's some really interesting partnerships that we're going to be launching coming up into next year that I'm very, very excited for. On top of that, just seeing all the tech that they have and being able to work with the same people they worked with to build theirs to integrate into White Glove. I mean, we have a soft launch of our advisor portal that came out this year, along with our one-on-one workshops, you know, direct advisor leads that get funneled right into our advisor portal that advisors can see not only the registrant data, but then appended data onto that to give them more financial insight. And that's really like step one of where that program is going to go. And then you add in our post-engagement nurturing systems that are, you know, email, text, phone calls, all built in for the advisor, all branded to the advisor. One thing we need to install in here is regular light switches so that lights don't turn it off, right? Yeah. But there's just so many things. I don't know that I've ever been as excited about where White Glove is headed as I am right now. Because seeing some of these things coming down the line and how well we've been able to adapt to the current industry and then get back to what we do for a living, right, with seminars. But if we would have had to build all these things while we were doing 800 to 1,000 events a month, it would have taken 5 years. So the ability for us to really deconstruct a lot of these processes, rebuild it in a more efficient and effective manner for the advisors, even just simple things like on our back end, our green zone technology that outlays all the marketing opportunities that are in the country and where advisors should go to host events. You know, now you pair that with one-on-ones or webinars or virtual options, or, hey, this is in your backyard, do a seminar here. Like that alone, that data that we have is just massive, you know, combined with some of the other opportunities that we have down the road. I'm very excited to see where White Glove can head.
Yeah, that's really cool. I hadn't known that. And you're right. I mean, some of those organizations that you reference, those are some of the best digital data companies that are out there. I mean, they have to be because of the nature of the consumer data that they come across on a regular basis, or they just wouldn't be successful. So you talk about those types of those companies and how they've spun up, they've grown, they've bought, they've sold, they've acted really, really smart in making sure that they work with consumer data to make decisions, whether it's for the consumer directly or it's for the mortgage brokers, the financial advisor, right, whomever they work with. So yeah, that's, yeah, and I totally and see where y'all are coming from. To do that yourselves, not only would it take you 5 years, but it would take an army to do it, you know. So why not leverage the people who have already been doing it for 5 years and the research and the smarts that they've obtained, I guess, in that time frame. That's cool. Yeah, excited to see what that all turns into, because I do think that companies like White Glove that are doing things like this will be the ones that will survive. For sure. You know, overnight, I joke all the time, overnight, everybody became, you know, your pizza delivery guy all of a sudden was the best Facebook advertiser.
I know. I felt so bad for advisors in the industry, because they have, you know, we've been doing this for 6 years now. I mean, we know what they're doing and why it's so cheap and why they're getting all these registered. Like, we know that, like, we know how it works, but it's so hard to convey that to an advisor. And, you know, there's, when webinars or, you know, leads came out, there was this big vacuum in the industry, right, where seminars weren't available anymore. That, yeah, I always say it's somebody that still lives in their mom's basement, right? Now they're the newest annuity lead generation company on the block or whatever. But, you know, a lot of advisors went out there and they tried this stuff and they got burned. And now they think webinars don't work or virtual doesn't work. It's like, well, you know, that the cheapest kid on the block didn't work, right?
The pros are still
doing it. Yeah, I mean, we've done more than 2,000 consumer facing webinars since COVID. So
yeah, so they're, yeah, and that's where I was going with that, is those folks will they'll probably move industries. You know, I think companies that spun up like that, individual marketers, whatever they were, that were created over the past 12 to 18 months, let's say, I think that there'll be a lot of drop off, as there already has been, as they realize how difficult it is, or they've just been unsuccessful. And then the flip side, which you all know well and have the ability to go into portals and get a quicker turnaround, is the compliance side. You know, that is, I have a friend of mine who runs a digital marketing company for fitness, and I've told the story before on the show, and I always, you know, joke around and say, man, that's, you got it easy. In the fitness industry, you can post whatever you want, whenever you want. There's nobody looking at your stuff.
That's right. Guaranteed results, right? 6 weeks.
There's not a person in financial services that can say guaranteed. And right. So we don't, and for obvious reasons. But yeah, so that, you know, that's, I think, probably the biggest splash of cold water in the face for these new marketers is, holy cow, when I'm working with a SEC licensed individual, I can't be saying those types. It's not as easy to market. You really have to get your message across by the regulators, and then also drive business and education to the industry. So,
and it's tough too, because a lot of the things that other companies are doing, they're not going through the same compliance protocols that White Glove does every time. We went out and got pre-approved by probably 80 plus broker dealers at this point, and, you know, thousands of RIAs, where they get to see everything that we do. They see every single ad before it turns on. We make full compliance packages for everything. And then you have these other guys, just, you know, the one-offs that are running the advisor's Facebook page and running an ad, where an advisor might not know that if someone comments on one of those ads, it could be construed as financial advice, right? And are you tracking that properly? Did you run that through your compliance? Are they monitoring it? You know, there's stuff like that the industry is just, you know, everybody looks at things differently. And if you don't exactly know what you're supposed to be doing, it can get scary out there for an advisor. And it's always work with those that are trusted and have already went through those compliance, you know, call them, you know, fiery loopholes that you jump through, right? But it's all there to protect the advisors and protect the end consumers at the end of it. So.
Yeah. And that's a good point too, is to, you know, you want your clients to work with somebody who they trust. You should be taking that same exact motto when looking at partners or alliances or providers for your business as well too, because it does all trickle downhill. Well, man, this has been great. As we started off by saying, I'm sure there's tons of stuff in there that everyone was able to pick up on from all of your expertise, and what you guys have coming down the pipe is even more exciting. It sounds like the data stuff that is definitely the here and now, but how folks like you all corral that, aggregate it, and then put it back out into products and services for our joint clients would be pretty cool to watch. So appreciate your time and your partnership working with all of our guys and gals, and looking forward to seeing you in these three-dimensional lands sometimes.
Yeah, we've got to get back at it one of these days. So
yeah. Well, thanks, man. Be good. We'll see you soon.
All right, brother. Thanks for having me on. Appreciate it.